So we're going to spend a little bit of time. We're going to start at a really high level here. We're going to talk about data automation, some of the trends that we see in the market. But we are going to get pretty technical, and we're going to get pretty deep. So hopefully there's something here for everybody. I do want to preface with folks, we're not doing a product demo. So if you are curious as to how Ascend works, as mentioned, we're right over here. Also, look for our lovely team in the very bright red Big Data is a Cluster t-shirts. If you go get a demo, we will also give you a Big Data is a Cluster t-shirt. And I'm really excited to dive in. So where I really want to start is talking about a new scale challenge. We've seen a lot of really great innovation, and a lot is happening in and around data. But we're entering into a new era here. And so we're going to dive into that. And we're going to spend some time talking about the role of automation, and in particular, the paradigm shift from imperative to declarative systems. We're going to go deeper into some of the technical aspects of that. Going to give folks who want to build a system like Ascend even a few pro tips and tricks. And then we're going to talk about some of the real-world scenarios as to how to drive benefit from automation platforms like Ascend. So first, let's talk about the modern-day scaling challenge. Today, we see 95% of data teams are at or over capacity. We've run a survey every year, and for 3 years in a row, this number hasn't changed. And in fact, I would contend this number is probably going to get worse given the current market climate. 95% of teams have no capacity to take on new workloads. And I think there's a really important reason, and you're going to hear about this from many folks here, which is data is no longer the byproduct of our businesses. Today, data is the product. Software went and ate the world. Every company became a software company, and lo and behold, every company is becoming a data company. And I think this is really important, as we are now being built, the foundation of our companies, on top of these incredible backbones of new technology. Yet this is oftentimes how we're pulling that technology together. And this is simply not a scalable process. So one thing we did at the start of the year, the independent survey, 500 data experts, all the way from chief data officer down to data scientists, data engineers, data architects. And we asked a really simple question. Are you currently or do you intend on investing in automation to increase your team's capacity? And the responses were really insightful. Only 3.5% of people today say they invest in automation. 3.5%. There are a lot more people who use existing ETL tools, ELT tools, scheduling systems, and so on. But only 3.5% consider that they are tapping into the potential of modern-day automation. Yet 85% intend on using automation in the next 12 months. This is a remarkable gap. And it highlights that there is a significant need for more leverage. And we find that that pain is even more acute today in today's current market landscape than ever before. So let's talk a little bit about the role of automation itself. When I'm an engineer and I'm building a data pipeline, why does automation matter? Well, ultimately, I have six very simple questions that I have to write code for as an engineer to do the job. When do I run my code? Well, to answer that question, I have to figure out, did I already run my code on this data? Do I need to run it again? Well, oftentimes that depends on, did my data change? Did my code change? And then lastly, what happened to the data I used before? Where did it go? What happened to it? What other code ran on it? These are really simple questions in theory, but most systems today are not geared to be able to properly answer these systems or these questions. And as a result, we spend disproportionately large percentage of our times, of your team's times, answering these questions in codified logic. We employ a historically imperative model for data engineering that is based on timers, triggers, and sensors that basically is re-implementing what a query engine would do for a database. It's tracking dependencies, managing ingest, it's doing data profiling, it's doing formatting, all sorts of work that is non-differentiated and highly repeatable in today's modern era. So what we've done and figured out how to do at Ascend is to flip that model on its head. And we followed very similar modern-day cloud-based engineering patterns and moved from an imperative engineering model to a declarative engineering model. This takes the classic scheduler and pipeline logic and inverts it. And it puts the engineer on top of the stack, leveraging a declarative control plane that is metadata-driven, context-aware, and continuously running that is operating on behalf of your engineer. Same benefits that you get from container orchestration with Kubernetes are the same kind of benefits you can get in a declarative paradigm with a control plane for data pipelines. So when we think about what that looks like from an architectural pattern, we separate the world into three distinct layers. You have a logic plane, a control plane, and a data plane. And the key introduction here is obviously that control plane. But it's very important in a declarative model to highlight that a logic plane defines what? The expected state of data. It frees the developer from having to worry about the conditional logic, the steps required to achieve that outcome, but instead focuses their effort on what you expect to happen. In doing so, we can push tremendous power and capability into that control plane that can act on behalf of the developer, greatly easing the burden of building data pipelines. Inside of that control plane is a significant amount of logic, automation, and we'll dive into that a little bit more. Inside of that control plane is deep levels of metadata. It is important, and I would argue even critical, for a modern-day data application built on top of a control plane. You must be metadata-driven. Metadata exists all over the place, and in many ways, metadata is now becoming the new big data challenge itself. The volume of metadata you need to collect to highly automate systems is significant. You need to track all the metadata around the data itself, the jobs that process data, who's accessing the data, what they're doing with the data, the profile of the data, and more. Second, with that metadata, you must build a system that is context-aware. It must be domain-specific. It must understand the nature of the data and the code itself. What we have figured out how to do at Ascend is to actually link code and data together. We know the exact version of the exact piece of code that generated each and every single piece of data throughout the entire data lifecycle. And I'll get into why that matters so much. I'm also going to tell folks how we do that in case people want to try and build this thing at home too. But it's incredibly important to be able to link those two together. If you cannot link your code and data together, you are setting yourself for a very, very, very hard challenge of building a highly automated system. And then lastly, you must build a system that can continuously operate. The world is too real-time. The world is too adaptive. It is too reactive. If you are building systems that just run on timers and triggers, you are missing out on tremendous opportunity to move faster and actually safely across your business. And so a control plane is intentionally designed to run continuously and be dynamic and respond to changes in both code and data. Y'all with me so far? All right. So let's look at the eye chart and figure out how we do this. So what does that actually start to look like? Well, if we break these planes up into the logic plane, the data plane, the control plane, and the data plane here, it requires a huge amount of tracking of that metadata. At the top level, it's components. It's data sources, transformations, data sinks, et cetera. But beneath that is really where the exciting stuff happens. Beneath that is where we get to start to track data. And data isn't just a table inside of your warehouse or your lake or your really cool lake house. It's far more than that. It's partitions of data, it's fragments of data, it's schemas, it's profiles, it's jobs that generated that data. There's volumes and volumes and volumes of that data and the metadata that surrounds it that inform an automated system to be able to determine what it's supposed to do, when it's supposed to do it, and why. And so one of the things that we have done internally at Ascend is we track everything. As I mentioned, metadata itself is now also a big data problem. It is imperative that you take a cloud-first, a cloud-native approach to even solving the metadata problem, as you need that tremendous potential and volume and scale to solve even metadata in advanced layers of automation. So we track those profiles, we track the jobs, we track the resources, we track the clusters, we track the warehouses all the data's processed in. Anything we can collect, we do. Now, one of the key elements here is this notion of a SHA. All right, let's see. Fellow nerds, who knows what a SHA is? Who's heard the term a fingerprint? All right, a SHA is a secure, there we go, I got somebody on a walk-by. A SHA and a fingerprint, secure hash algorithm. It is like us as people, a fingerprint, a small shorthand notion of uniquely identifying a large body of information. We actually fingerprint all of the code and all of the data and bind it together. And in doing so, we are able to detect when change happens rapidly inside of a system. And in doing so, we can rapidly detect when code changes, when data changes. And in doing so, rapidly determine and reactively respond to changes in the system on behalf of developers. So what this looks like, and if people want to see the pretty UI-based demo of how these algorithms work in person, again, I'll highlight right over there. But how this works is at tremendously large scale in tracking trillions of records and millions of partitions across thousands and thousands of data transformations. The SHA-based structure around how you fingerprint your code and your data and how you bind these together allows you to answer those six key questions, and in doing so, elevate your team out of the monotony and the muckery of building standard data pipelines and up-level. And so when we think about how a SHA algorithm works inside of Ascend, how we work is really simple. These questions in automating a data pipeline become dramatically easier when you have a declarative control plane and SHA-based architecture, as the integrity checking of that system itself allows us to answer these questions very fast and very succinctly, which is, when do you run your code? You continuously evaluate. You run it when the SHAs don't match. How do you know? You constantly check your SHAs. The brilliance and the beauty of these automated control planes we see across industries is that they generate this fingerprint, this blueprint, in fact, of what the entire world's supposed to look like, and compare that with what the world looks like today. It can simply differentiate between the things that exist and what work has to happen to get your data to the end state. And as a result, this makes it very easy for you to traverse and track those changes across the entire lifecycle of data, across disparate teams, across disparate data silos, because of these integrity checks tied to your data. And so in our last couple of minutes here, just wrapping up on what does this really mean from a real-world scenario, and how does that actually work on a platform like Ascend and other highly automated systems? You know, at first, it's really simple. You create data read connectors, just like you would in any other system. They do a little bit more. Not only are they constantly checking for new data across dozens, hundreds even, of different systems, but they watch for new data. And when they find new data, not only do they ingest that data, but they also profile that data. They create their own blueprints and their own fingerprints of that data. But you get to start to do really neat things. The classic smart backfill of data. My engineers just changed some logic in the pipeline, and I can't tell you what version of that pipeline code generated the version of data that is now fueling our finance report. It's scary. Having automated systems like this are capable of doing fully automated backfill on smart code changes that greatly alleviate that burden. Similarly, error recovery. On a declarative system with a control plane, systems fail, creates no problem for the underlying system. The integrity checking kicks in, the fingerprint checking validates, and you get to retry your jobs and commit your data just as you ordinarily would. Thirdly, incremental data propagation. One of the classic challenges of big data systems, how to do it efficiently, is when you have a large new block of data coming in, but you have an even larger block of existing data, how do you not have to reprocess the entire world of data? Incremental data propagation in a declarative model with this fingerprinting becomes dramatically easier as you can run many jobs in parallel far more efficiently. And then lastly, one of the really advanced things that we figured out how to do on top of this as well is start to do things like mid-pipeline data SHA computation that says even if your data logic changes but the data itself doesn't, we no longer have to process that data anymore, as we can detect that there is no fundamental change to the data, and as a result, continue to drive efficiency and better utilization into your underlying warehouse and cluster because of the smarts built into that metadata and that automation engine itself. So I know I'm at time. Hopefully this gives you all just a taste of some of the really powerful, really advanced things that you get to start to do when you move into a more automated approach to how you build your data pipelines. And if you have any questions, as a reminder, chat with all those excited, energetic folks in the bright red shirts, or just see us in our booth right on over there. I'm Sean Knapp, and thank you all for attending our talk.